My name is Francis. From the age of 10, I've been in trouble with the law. I started off stealing from small shops, then onto bigger stores and armed robbery. This to me was normal. I thought this is what people done. At the age of 15, I was put into a secure unit. It was a college of crime. I learned how to break into houses better. I learned how to steal cars better. I'd never had any qualifications. No one had ever given me the chance. From stealing, I went on to hard drugs. I loved them. They couldn't answer me back. I first became involved with Ultras in prison. I was speaking to one of the education staff about my options. It was a chance for me to get the fresh start I had been looking for. I can't thank you enough for starting up an organization which has saved my life. I've never been in trouble with the law since I started the team program. My life is now about helping people rather than hurting people. Well done on 30 years of success stories like mine. I mean, it is rather wonderful, isn't it? And so, I'm going to write back to him.
30 years ago, the Prince of Wales launched a trust to support the young people of Britain who needed help to transform their lives.
He is such a socially conscious man, and I think he understands that the future of a country relies on its youth.
Oh, dig that crazy rhythm.
I mean, he is a pretty odd conflict of ideals and ideas, a foot firmly in the polo stirrup, and a foot very sympathetically planted in the neediest quarter of society.
For the past year, we've had unique access to the Prince of Wales, at home at Clarence House, and with the Duchess of Cornwall.
I've seen that face before.
And the young princes, as he goes about the country on his work for the Prince's Trust. This is a story of a prince and the people, of the famous and the forgotten.
Of rock stars and prisons.
Sport and heroes.
And drug addicts.
Of Hollywood stars.
And homeless teenagers.
The Prince's Trust has helped over 500,000 people, the size of a city like Edinburgh.
And do you go to the dentist occasionally to get your teeth done?
No, I don't.
No!
God. This is the story of the Prince's Trust.
This was, you know, my grandmother's place. I don't know, I always think it's got such a wonderful atmosphere. I love it.
It is, it is.
And I always love this corridor when you come in.
It's a gorgeous house.
As you come in, you see this, you look all the way along. She was very clever, my grandmother, long time ago in finding that Monet, for instance.
Oh, yes.
And at a time when people really weren't all that interested in the
in Monet.
Impressionist.
And who, and that portrait of
her.
Graham
Sullivan. And, Noel Coward was a great friend of hers. Oh, we had such fun after dinner. He'd play the piano and sing.
And sing, so yes.
I adored him. He came to my 21st birthday party. But that he painted that and gave it to my grandmother. She used to have lunch in here very often. Mm-hmm. There was always a... She had a marvellous thing which gave the racing results.
Oh. Always the racing results.
But you see, the other thing she did, which was brilliant, I think, was to think ahead and asked this artist, John Piper, to do paintings of Windsor Castle during the war in case it was bombed, in case it disappeared.
Yes.
Which is terribly important, all that.
Yes.
I have learned a lot from my grandmother,
yes,
that thinking ahead. I always feel that's the sort of exhausted private secretary standing in the back. Oh, God, what's he thinking of next?
Right? Yes,
he's,
yes,
dreaming up another initiative.
Yes, they are rather baleful eyes.
Well, don't you think?
Yes.
I've seen them before. We did a survey a few years ago of people's attitudes towards the Trust. And it transpired that most people had heard of the Trust, but actually didn't have any idea what he did other than run pop concerts. That's why I've been giving an interview to Sir Trevor MacDonald. I mean, I hope I may have done my best to answer some of his questions, at any rate.
In that drama, The Madness of King George, Alan Bennett wrote that the Prince of Wales is not a title so much as it's a predicament. When you were encountering these difficulties about getting the trust off the ground, did you have any sympathy with that view?
Oh, I probably had a lot of sympathy with it over the years, yeah. Because there's only one person who knows what it's like, you know, in each generation who has to do this. But I'm all in favor of putting, you know, advantages into practice. And the value of my particular position is I can try to bring people together, to look at particular issues that I can try and flag up. In fact, all I've ever wanted to do is to help and reintegrate things that are disintegrated and heal things that are... that need healing, you know. So that's the way I've always looked at it. So, but that's just me. It just happens to be the way I look at things.
In philosophical terms, what was it that drove you to do this?
I think it was probably partly my education. The thing about Gordonston, that school I was sent to in Scotland, was that it basically tried to encourage people to take the initiative and not sit around expecting other people to do anything. You know, the main principle underlying the school was that in order to be able to help the transition from childhood to adulthood, you needed to give young adolescents responsibility. And one of the great things at the school was we had our own, can you believe this, fire service, Coast Guard service, mountain rescue. And we actually did it properly. I mean, the fire service had their own fire engine. I was in the Coast Guard. We had our own breaches boys and everything else, rockets. We manned a, you know, lookout station in bad weather and everything, longing for ships to come aground so we could rescue everybody. But all I can tell you is, of course, it was such a wonderful way of, by giving people responsibility, it helped them to achieve this a bit more self-confidence and self-esteem. And then you were enabled to do all sorts of other things. I just felt that one way, perhaps, to deal with some of the complications of life was to give people these opportunities at a younger age.
My name's Kinder Carter, and I'm 29 years old. The trust, they gave me a loan of £4,000 and a grant of £1,000 to buy an existing business building staircases. My background, really, is a bit kind of up in the air. I sort of started to get involved in using drugs, and my days were numbered when I got caught with some and I ended up going to prison. It was during that time that I started learning how to use machinery in the joinery workshop in the prison. And they were amazed at what I was doing. And that's when they sort of introduced me to the Prince's Trust and told me a bit about them, about how they fund people like myself to start basically start businesses.
The RBS Enterprise Award goes to Kinder Carter.
This is going really well. I've got plenty of orders on. I've got plenty of work coming in regularly. And I'm just getting better at what I do slowly.
Pleasure to make it.
Well done.
Yes.
Anyway, things getting better now.
It's great, all of it. It's really, really
so good. Well, I hope this helps a bit.
Well, it has given me, as they say, the quite kick up the bum. Do you know what I mean? That's your way to go, and that's the way you're going to go. Can I introduce you to my nan, by the way?
Hello, I'm pleased to meet you.
Somebody's got a drink round here.
The trust seeing potential in people that very often society turns its back on, I think, is a direct result of the vision of the Prince of Wales. I mean, that is what he set up the trust to achieve. That is my brief, if you like, and what I'm tasked with trying to do.
Martina Milburn had been running BBC's Children in Need.
Hello, Leslie. How are you?
She had all sorts of inventive ideas about how we could tackle the many problems facing the trust.
The Prince obviously doesn't get involved in operational things. He does act like a chairman or a president. But in terms of strategy, how we take the trust forward, then the Prince knows about it.
Only better than giving a kiss on a stage. come and have a seat.
Well, I think I've got some good news, actually, sir.
Hello, I'm Jon Snow, and normally I'm a news presenter, but on this occasion I'm talking to you about the Prince's Trust and how on earth I got involved in the very earliest days. I was working in a day centre for homeless teenagers. Drugs, alcohol, mental illness, crime. There was a huge number of dispossessed, unattended to young people who needed help.
The whole theme in the 70s was the decline of Britain. I mean, I was at The Economist magazine at the time, and I remember writing stories using a gas storm lamp because there was a strike, there was no electricity.
These severe power cuts will mean hardship for every man, woman and child in the country.
I seem to write about nothing but strikes and industrial decline and the social decay of our inner cities. There were 3-day weeks.
I don't think that other people in the world would share the view that there is mounting chaos. You know, we've had strikes before. We've come close to the brink before.
The country was essentially bankrupt, and the stench of decline was everywhere. It was probably the most miserable decade since the end of the Second World War.
I'd have been a blinding idiot if I hadn't paid some attention to this sort of thing. I remember thinking, I'm sure there's something I can do to help here. And then, of course, I wanted to try and get stuck in when I came out of the Navy.
I was in the office of the day centre one day, and the phone went, and I picked it up, and a very plummy voice said,
"This is Buckingham Palace."
I thought, this has got to be a spoof. This cannot be for real.
He said, "I'm the equerry to the Prince of Wales, and he'd very much like it if you'd come and see him to talk about the work you're doing."
I remember his opening remarks very clearly. He started talking about the sort of idea he had. This would be a kind of foundation of money which he would make available to help raise. It was much more to kind of empower people rather than necessarily, run things for them.
The Prince is here to look at some of the activities by the youth groups around Cheshire who've been supported or have had grants from the Prince of Wales Trust.
You know, the people for whom, with whom, about whom it was going to be spent would have a say, a big say. And he seemed genuinely interested, and I thought quite well informed.
He was probably pretty amazed to find, I suppose, he thought somebody like myself couldn't possibly be interested in all these things, which always rather annoyed me. I mean, it was something that I'd worked out myself. I didn't need other people to tell me that this was a good thing that I should be doing.
I don't think Prince Charles's background mattered. Indeed, I think it was an advantage in the sense that it was like a megaphone dragging attention to it, which is why it was quite politically risky as well, because there was an implicit criticism that here in the British welfare state, which was supposed to have a safety net through which nobody should fall, there were people falling, and non-government action was needed to help these people, that the government alone wasn't enough. And if it hadn't been Prince Charles, it would have had to have been somebody else.
In a very real sense, sir, you and the Trust were getting involved in areas of social policy.
The trouble is, you're in a no-win situation, aren't you, really? Because if you do absolutely nothing at all and stuff all, they're going to complain about that, aren't they? So if you try and get stuck in to do something to help, they also complain. So at some point, you just have to say, I'm going to do it, and that's that.
But some people thought you were being a nuisance.
Oh, yes. Probably. Recent years and of trying to get the Trust to get involved in is this whole issue of the lack of skills, vocational skills, in this country. There's a huge black hole, and it's something that has worried me for a long time.
Prince Charles is about to come over and shake hands with us or whatever.
pretty nervous. Yeah, I can hardly breathe. I'm like...
Hello. Hello. You're the Drystone.
So how many jobs have you got going at the same time?
Probably about four, but I've got another job from the Princess Trust.
Another one?
Today, yeah, so I've got about five.
What, somebody's house? Or...
Yeah, someone's house, yeah. So...
Well done. Yeah. Oh, there's so many collapsing walls. They all need more stone wallers.
Yeah. Anyway, it's lovely to see you. Many congratulations. I assume we're going to have to be calling you down south again to come and repair something.
All right, okay, yeah.
For your car.
Oh, yeah.
Just in case.
Oh, that's
a car.
Very important to take the car.
I was very keen to see through the Prince's Trust whether we could contribute something to this situation by helping to provide young people with opportunities to pick up rural skills. It seems to me absolutely crucial for the future that we have people who can understand how to manage the countryside.
Darling, have you met Luke? He's nearly at the end of his course.
Hello. Very nice. And, you're not going to ask us to demonstrate.
No, I don't think we'll ask that today.
I don't think I can back it.
We did
this.
A risk assessment before we invited you along to make sure.
I see we've had to all run over.
Well, that's right.
And who's are these look like Texels to me? They are extraordinary creatures, aren't they? You have to train people, you have to encourage, you have to invest in order to have something very often 20 years down the line. Otherwise, if you don't bother about that, we won't have anybody who knows how to do anything. Now, I'm just off to visit a character we set up in business, gosh, 20 years ago now, I think. And it's called Attic. And one of the co-founders set it up in the attic belonging to his grandmother. And now it's become a multinational design company with offices in San Francisco, New York, and in London, and they're turning over £10 million a year. And when you think about it, it's not bad for £1,000 grant from the start.
We just left college, we were about 19 years old. We looked like kind of faded punk rock stars. And we actually approached the banks, high street banks, and it was just a no at every bank. I found out about the trust through my dad, who had been chatting to a bloke in the pub. He came home and just said, apparently Prince Charles has started a charity to fund young people who want to start their own business.
This is my grandma's house, where we actually started.
Is she still going strong?
No, unfortunately not. Not for 10 years now, but
really?
She'll be very proud, I'm sure. Mm. We received £1,000 grant, and this piece of equipment, this huge camera, it's a dinosaur piece today, but at the time it was essential for us to start our own business.
It wasn't as sophisticated as it is today. You know, it's more than just money today. It's about mentoring and offering advice and holding hands with people who start a business.
It's an accepted fact, I think, that small businesses form, to all intents and purposes, the most important part of any country's economy. And it's something that's easily forgotten. And again, it was all part of the process of trying to help people to develop their particular skills, talents, potential. So in terms of the Prince's Trust, our business startup program, it really began entirely as a result of and reaction to the Toxteth riots. And it was at that time, I remember, when there were these appalling riots, I just felt, how can we find ways of giving these characters more opportunity, because the whole thing is based on frustration, alienation, alien.
Rapidly increasing unemployment, urban decay, and tensions with the police in the inner cities created frustrations that boiled over into the worst rioting Britain had ever seen.
For the first time, CS gas was fired during a riot in England. It seemed to do little to quell the mob, who kept police at bay with petrol bombs, bricks, and any missile they could lay hands on.
There's nothing out there, there's only about 7 jobs for so many people.
What do you do with yourself then?
Stay in bed.
To make matters worse, 3 years later, the country was torn apart as striking miners fought to save their jobs.
I was just trying to find ways of reacting to the situation so that as unemployment grew, and, you know, it was 3 million or something, and as these traditional industries were shut down, what on earth are we going to find to replace these forms of employment for so many people? It was all taking so long, you know, for anything else to spring up. So I just felt whatever the, you know, we could do in a small way would be better than nothing. That was what led to the Youth Business Initiative.
But when we talk about unrest in the inner cities, rioting, unemployment over 3 million, and you talk about the work of the trust, I look at that and I think, but they are also problems to be addressed by governments. And here was the trust, not replacing, but certainly, you know, in an area which could be described as government policy area.
Well, you could, but then on the other hand, you know, I've always looked for the gaps where perhaps government isn't able to do something. And in a funny way, it's easier perhaps for a, you know, a charitable organization to be lighter on its feet, not so, you know, bureaucratic perhaps.
But when you hear ministers now talk about inner city problems and when you see them make visits to inner cities and so on, you probably sit back and quietly say to yourself, if to nobody else, we were there before, we were in this area.
I wouldn't dream of presuming such a thing.
I thought you wouldn't.
I don't think Prince Charles has remained politically neutral, but he's been careful not to be party political. I mean, Prince Charles is now known for a host of strong points of view on everything from architecture to education, and of course the social policies that are involved and implicit in the Prince's Trust. And he has courted controversy, and he's been attacked at times. Well, it's better to be attacked than to be known for simply being a rich and privileged waster. He very cleverly stayed away from party politics, and I think that's why he's managed to get away with it. Yes, he's been involved in our public debate, but he hasn't been party pre. He hasn't taken sides.
Well, it isn't quite like any normal boss, is it? Because he's the heir to the throne. But off camera, he's very funny. I mean, I'd say that was my principal thing we enjoy together, is laughing.
Well, Tom Shabir, I think, came to see me back 1987.
We had quite a lively, well, I wouldn't describe it as a straight-up argument, but, you know, frank exchange of views.
He did the most wonderful job in helping to turn the trust into something much more effective and much, much bigger.
I remember quite early on coining this idea, we had to be good enough to make a difference, so really good with an individual and try to make them successful. Give them an opportunity, try to make them successful, and stick not for a month or 2 months, years if necessary.
I was in a band from like 12 years old, just knocking about with different musicians, just trying to find our way, really, doing something out of boredom. And like any band, really, you don't really have much money and you can't really get gigs if you haven't got equipment to make money. So we wrote a letter to the Prince's Trust and I was shocked that a cheque of 300 quid came through the door. So we tried it a few times and it wasn't too easy the next few times, but we did have another cheque for about 800 quid because the speakers that we'd bought with the 300 quid had got nicked, so they gave us some more money, which is handy.
As we'd helped give groups of young equipment, for instance, you know, to start off their own particular ventures, we had helped to start quite a lot of musical groups off. And I thought, after some years, I thought, wouldn't it be fun to try and see if we could get some of these characters together, see who were doing really well, and to have a concert where they could perform, but with others.
The very first time I heard about it was George Martin. He was asked to organise a concert for the Prince's Trust, which was very, very new and relatively completely unknown, really.
The founders of the Prince's Trust really had invented a new form, which was the multi-artist single band, and started making money, which within a year was raising between £1 and 2 million a night. We only had one a year, but that was a fantastic source of money.
I bought him some earplugs, actually, for a birthday present. You know, a little sort of silver thing with a crest on. And he was very, very pleased with those, because some of it he didn't like. But, I mean, it was because it was for his trust, and he knew that this would make a bit of a difference.
Up here,
baby. Well, no, I mean...
All over.
It was Phil who suggested that it would be a good idea to try and draw in some other people like himself to help become ambassadors, rather like he was.
Hi, I'm Jensen Button. I'm a Formula One driver and I'm an ambassador for the Prince's Trust.
I'm Jay Jagger and I'm a designer and creative director.
I'm Rio Ferdinand. I play for Man United in England.
I'm Pierce Brosnan and I'm an actor.
Hello, my name is Gwyneth Paltrow.
The reason we're using celebrities is because they can help, I think, appeal to so many more young. They can draw people into the trust. They can act as role models far better than I can.
I started in theatre and education. And if I hadn't been an actor, I might have been a social worker. There's a lot of work done in South London, so I had a fair kind of understanding of young people who are adrift in life and shamed by society.
I remember when I was a kid, if anybody who I really looked up to come into a room, they've just got me fixated for the whole time, and you remember more what they've said than a lot of other people. I think that's the most inspiring thing that you're going to get for kids.
Well, you know, I've got kids myself, so I know that fashion is of utmost importance to our younger generations. It's the same with Drama Live, it's the same with our Sound Live programme on music. We basically use any hook we can to attract those young people to the Trust.
OK, so we've got Joe Fiennes here this morning.
Can you take us through your toughest audition?
I could tell you my Star Wars story if you want. It was down to me and Ewan McGregor. It was all big Hollywood stuff. George Lucas was there. I finished, I came down. I said, George, how'd it go? He was, Joe, you were great, you were great. And I thought, Obi-Wan, here I come. I couldn't believe it. And then his daughter came up, aged like 4 or 5, and she looked at me and went, Daddy, I don't like him, he's not right. And he looked at me like...
of very high-profile ambassadors, and they're not just there to go and visit the projects. An awful lot of them get involved as fundraisers.
And that's all ultimately anybody wants, to be happy. And to be happy doesn't really mean to be sitting and grinning in a puddle of alcohol or drugs or sitting on a desert island being burnished by maidens. It actually means feeling fulfilled. I know, I'm going to Brazil tomorrow, where I'll be burnished, if not by maidens, by somebody charming, I know. But...
We set up a dinner with an auction afterwards with some really amazing prizes, which is where our ambassadors are incredibly generous.
I recently donated a yoga lesson. I'm going to teach a yoga lesson. And it was in aid of the trust.
Yoga with Gwyneth Paltrow. I'd like you all to reflect on what that means to the financial markets tomorrow. At £30,000, I'm selling Gwyneth Paltrow yoga instructor. On to redeem and sold.
Someone spent a good deal of money on it, so I'll have to really come up with an excellent plan. Unfortunately, I can't, you know, do it in the nude or do anything to really make it exceptional, but I'll try to come up with a very good yoga plan for the lesson.